Good morning. How's everyone doing this morning? Can you just put your hands together and thank the Lord for another beautiful morning? Wow. Well, obviously, we're going to try to do something a little bit different this morning. Going to try it. And I'll be honest, I'm tired of doing all the announcements when I get up to preach. So we figured we'd do it on the second song and try to break it up a little bit. And my wife's going to start us out with the first announcement.
Yeah, we're changing it up a little bit. All right, so who's ready for Easter?
Yeah.
You may not know you're ready, but you're ready.
We're gonna... Hey, you know, most people just go from Christmas right into Valentine's Day. What did you say?
We were at Easter before Christmas.
Oh, yes.
But and next year we'll be at Easter, probably in the fall, so y'all get ready.
Yeah. You just go ahead. Just go ahead.
All right, so we're going to do something a little bit the same, but something a little bit different. Do you remember the journey from last year? Well, we are kind of doing that, but it's not going to be so much of a journey this year as it is going to be on the stage. And we're going to beef it up a little bit, so we're going to need more people. So we need anyone who wants to be involved in any way, whether you want to be on the stage, whether you want to be behind the scenes, we need you to come out for an informational meeting. And that will be this Thursday, January 19th at 6:30. So Thursday night, 6:30, be here in the sanctuary if you want to get more information or if you want to be a part of that or think you might want to be a part of that. Just come out and I'll tell you more about what that's going to be.
Look at your neighbor. Come on, look at your neighbor, seriously, and say, why don't you help us out this Easter? Yeah, get involved. It's a lot of fun. It builds relationships. It builds unity. It's one of the greatest things I think about this house is that in those different types of productions and different plays that we do, it builds the family, it unifies us, and it just builds those relationships a little bit stronger. I think I have
we need everyone. There's a place for you. You may think, well, I don't have anything to contribute. Yes, you do. You have more to contribute than you think you do. I don't care if you get stage fright, you don't know how to act, we still have a place where you can serve and where you can feel that you're contributing what the gifts that God has given to you. So come out, be a part of it.
It's a lot of fun.
So much fun.
Next Sunday morning at 10 a.m., we're doing our baptism service. I believe we have some adults and children signed up to be baptized. You can still do that. You can sign up through the church app or at the Welcome Center, or you can scan the QR code that's behind me on the screen and you can sign up that way. Also, about 6 months ago, God began to stir something in my heart. And it was before that he began to stir it in Tam's heart. But we are going to do a Experiencing God Bible study. It's by Henry Blackaby. I don't know if you know anything about Henry Blackaby, but this Bible study transformed my life. Many decades ago, when I first started my first pastorate and enterprise, there was a lady in our church, Carolyn Sloan. She was a great Bible teacher, and she started it. I think there was six of us that went through it, and it just radically it messed me up. And we're going to be doing that. I believe I'm going to hold the men's Bible study. I believe she'll hold the women's Bible study, but we're trying to find out what kind of interest there is to see if we need to do one for maybe married couples or 30s, 40s, 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, whatever. We're just trying to open 90s. Meanwhile, you could probably be teaching this thing.
She's at a class of her own.
but in this Bible study, you'll learn to discern how God is speaking to you, where He's speaking to you, where He's leading you, how He's leading you. You'll be able to identify God's voice when He speaks to you. And the big thing about experiencing God is that you find where God is working and you join Him there. That's part of what Easter is really all about. We know God is working on Easter. Let's just, we know where He's going to work, so let's just show up and join Him there. So anyway, you can sign up at the church app, or you can sign up at the Welcome Center, or you can also scan the QR code and sign up that way. And I believe my wife has the last announcement.
Yeah, so, we've got some women's opportunities coming up. This is just for the ladies. We have a self-defense class tailor-made just for the ladies. If you're interested, sign up on the church app at the info desk or scan the QR code behind me. Also, there's going to be a women's fitness class. It begins tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. in the Youth Worship Center. Just show up. Wear something comfy. You don't have to look good. You don't even have to know what you're doing. You don't have to be coordinated. None of that. Just come out and have fun. Be comfortable. Have fun and enjoy your time with some other ladies.
So tonight, there's a women's event going on tonight.
Yeah. So
you'll be speaking there.
I'm one of the speakers there. Yeah, that's going to be in, I believe, the youth room, right, Estella?
It's in the youth room. Yeah. It starts at 6:30. I believe that you all are going to eat. And, you know, I got to thinking about this last night. Sometimes I do things last minute. I can do things last minute, and it's okay. When she does things last minute, it completely messes me up.
So true.
But it is true. But last night I was sitting there thinking, you know, what's the guys going to do? And there was a time at Maranatha when the guys would just pick a place to go eat, and we would all just show up there and eat. And tonight... Joey's made contact with Billy Sundays down in Taze Valley. One of the ladies that is highly participates in our kids ministry. Her and her husband own Billy Sundays. All the men that want to show up there, we will meet there at 6:30. We'll eat. I don't know anything about it. I heard they have pretty good food, so we're going to show up there. Any guy who wants to, 6:30 tonight, meet me at Billy Sunday's. We'll have probably a burger or a chicken sandwich or French fries or something, but we'll just see what happens and have a good time, okay? Tell your neighbor now be a good time to give. You can give by internet. You can give by text give. You can black boxes. You know how to do it. Would everyone please make welcome our St. Mary's campus this morning. And during our second song, we're going to start doing something new here at Maranatha. I'm going to invite all of our first responders or our altar workers to come forward at this time. I believe we have 10 of them that signed up this morning. And what I would like to do is that during this second song, into the third song, fourth, fifth, it doesn't matter. If you have something you want prayer for, I just want you to be able to come forward to these men and these women and just ask for prayer and let them pray over you. And we're just going to believe with you that God's going to move and transform and show up in a great way in your life. So during this second song, I just want you to come. If you have a need, I want you to come. If you're walking through a difficult time, just come and let these men and women encourage you. You go ahead, Joey. God bless you. We'll see you in a few minutes.
On the God of David. children, then you hear your children.
He hears you.
He's the same God.
Oh, yes, he is.
You are the same God. You answer prayers by
now. He's answering now.
You will answer now. You are the same God.
Aren't you glad?
You are the same God.
All you gotta do is ask him now, 'cause he is the same. because there's nothing, Lord God, that you can't do. Woo! Wow. We got on that one on the lepers. You know, some of you probably in here feel like you're a leper. We have modern-day lepers. Yeah, if you had a sexual sin or you did something that the world says you're no good anymore, they just pitch you to the side. You're a modern-day leper. But God, Jesus Christ, didn't have a problem with putting his hands on a leper. Oh, no! Oh, no! Oh, no! Oh, God, we thank you that you are no respecter of persons. We thank you, God. Oh, hallelujah. No matter what you think you did, mama, you might think I'm an untouchable, but God says, no, you're not. No, you're not. If he can save, what's his name? The mass murderer, Dahmer, what's his name? Jeffrey Dahmer. If he can save that man, and I know some people say there's no way. Yes, he did. He accepted Christ before he died, before he gave his life. God forgave him. He can forgive anything but blaspheme in the Holy Ghost. Well, God, we praise you. Come on, let's lift up our hands and just thank him. God, thank you that you reached down and you saved my soul. You reached down, God. And Lord, I look at my bank account in heaven and it says there's no debts there. I thank you, God, that I'm clean, I'm forgiven, I'm healed, I'm whole, I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. Thank you, God, for the victory in Jesus' name.
And God says, do you really want it?
Well, come on.
There are so many people in this place right now. There is nothing too hard for God. There is nothing too small. I don't care if your little toe hurts. Why aren't you coming and asking him to do it? There are people here that want to pray with you. Do you really want it? Do you want to be healed? Do you want to be filled? Do you really want it? How long are you going to stay there beside the waters that you can't be thrown in? You have to take a step. Have to go forward. So come on. Is this all that people need here? Just these few people? God wants you today. He's your healer, Jehovah Rapha. He can do it. He will do it. He healed me. He healed me of Crohn's disease. There's no healing for that. I'm telling you, my God heals and he's real. He died on the cross for us. He took nails. He took the head and eye tails that beat him. It has a name. If you think he can't do it, did you think he really didn't do it then? He did it for you, and he did it for me. He got beat for us, and everything has a name on it. He went through that pain as he was going carrying the cross. He went through that pain. He went through that sickness. He felt every single thing that we felt. So come, let him do it for you.
Jesus.
Cause one name holds every victory. With one voice, the silence is the enemy.
Come on.
One King who reigns for all.
The ladies released it. So guys, we're going to drop it. We're going to, one name. I want the men. Yeah. It's time for men to rise up.
Yeah.
And begin to declare his name, Jesus. Why? Women don't care. They get to a point where they're like, Jesus, Jesus. Men are like the most reserved. It's like, you can be noisy at a WVU game. I'm sure you were screaming at the TV in the last 5 minutes of yesterday's defeat because they can't shoot a free throw. But you get into church, and the one thing you don't want to scream is Jesus, because you find it a sign of weakness. Oh, but it's a sign of victory, and it's a sign of strength. It's a sign of surrender when, hey, I can't do it. Listen, I'll be the first to tell you, I have run into situations, I run into them almost daily, that I can't do it. But Jesus said, that's right, you can't, I can. So I want to hear the men. Come on.
One name holds every victory.
Come on. Come on, men.
One voice that silences the enemy.
Come on.
One King who reigns for all eternity.
Say his name.
Jesus.
Come on, speak that name again.
It's Jesus.
Now all together, come on. Come on, ladies, join us.
Oh, one name holds every victory. One voice that silences the enemy. One King who reigns for all eternity.
Cause when you don't know what else to pray,
yeah.
And when you can't find the words to say,
yeah. Say
the name,
yeah. Of
Jesus, say the name of Jesus. Say the name. So precious. No other name I know. Say the name.
Say the name of Jesus.
Say the name
of Jesus.
Come on, speak it. Come on, out of your mouth. Jesus, come on. Jesus, release it. Oh. that I love to hear. I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear. It's the sweetest thing on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Come on, we don't like those moments where we just don't know and we wait, do we? Come on, can we just lift our hands? That's when you just say, God, whatever you want to do, right? See, you're waiting on one of us to just start into another chorus because it makes you uneasy. Well, I don't want to step where he isn't. I don't want to sing another chorus if he doesn't tell me to sing another chorus to appease you. So just, why don't you just lift your hand and say, God, whatever you want. Maybe he wants to speak to you right now.
You are wonderful, so wonderful, wonderful, so wonderful, Jesus.
We see release his name. See, we're singing about wonderful.
Yeah.
His name is wonderful. It's a name I love to hear. Well, you came up for prayer and you may leave not feeling it. It doesn't mean he's not wonderful. Well, I went up for prayer and nothing changed between here and the pew. That's okay. He heard. You invited him in. And while it may not happen instantaneously, he's still wonderful. So we sing, Jesus.
Jesus.
Death could not hold you. The veil tore before you. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring. The praise of your glory.
Come on, choir, sing with me.
For you, the praise of
you have, cause you have.
Submit ourselves to you right now. We ask of you to do what only you can do, the way that only you can do it. Lord, I pray you that you'd be with Mike Hawkins' mother right now that's in surgery at this moment. And Father, I pray that all fear be driven back, and I pray the peace of Almighty God would come. Lord, I pray you touch the hands of the surgeons and the neurosurgeons and the anesthesiologists. And Father, I pray that all outside activity would be gone from their mind and that she would be their primary focus. And Father, I pray that you'd bring a great healing forth inside of this woman's body. Father, I thank you for who you are. I thank you that you are great and you are strong. You are mighty. You are the all-sufficient one, God. All things are under your feet, God. At the sign of your face, it dispels all darkness, God. So, Father, we just invite you to come into our lives and do exactly what it is that you want to do in this moment. We thank you for it, and we ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Can you put your hands together? Thank the Lord this morning. Praise God. Thank you, Pastor Joey. The worship team, go ahead and give them a hand. They have done a phenomenal job. Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. Matthew 6, 33. This is the theme verse for this year of this house of Maranatha. It says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Seek first. Ask your neighbor, what are you looking for? I can't help but read this verse and think of another verse in Luke 12, 34. That it says, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Matthew, I think it's 7:7, says, if you look, you'll find. If you seek, it says, ask, seek, knock. If you ask, you'll receive. If you seek, you'll find. If you knock, it'll be opened to you. For wherever your treasure is, there will your heart be. Whatever you value, that's where your heart is. What are you looking for? Seek first, above everything else, it says, seek the kingdom of God. Actively looking for, mean the neck is stretched out and you're moving forward. I call this a turtle principle. Have you ever seen a turtle walking with its neck inside? No. The only way a turtle will move forward is when its neck is stretched out there. Meaning there is a chance that somebody's going to lop it off, but there is no forward movement without taking a risk. Right. Seek first the kingdom of God. If you're going to seek God, if you're going to seek His kingdom, there's going to be a little bit of a risk involved. There could be even a little price to pay, but I can tell you it's worth it. Even if you die trying to achieve it, it's worth it, because absent from the body is be present with the Lord. Praise God. Good preaching, preacher. This is seeking Jesus on how we are supposed to live. Seek first the kingdom of God. Can I tell you, you don't know how to live right. I'm just going to put it out there. You don't know how to live right. I know you think you do. I know you've been a Christian for 50 years, but you... outside of the Holy Spirit, outside of the kingdom of God, we don't know how to live. We get slipped up on the slightest little things. We think we know where everything is, right? I was reminded last night in my house, I thought I knew where everything was, but I didn't. My wife's been painting the bedroom. She wanted to change in the bedroom, or we're changing some of our house, and she liked the stand that was in the front living room more than the stand in the bedroom, Terry, so she moved out the old stand and moved in the new stand, but the old stand was left in the middle of the bedroom floor. And I was going to the restroom, and we installed this new light that has a delay. Why does it have a delay? I don't know why it has a delay. It had no instructions with it. I don't know. I was just thankful that it worked. I had to call one of the electricians in our church and say, hey, man, where's this blue wire go and red wire and white wire and yellow wire and all this? He talked me through it. It works. Even has a little remote. And when you turn the switch on, if you wait about 3 seconds, it'll beep and the light will come on. Well, everybody knows here I'm a very patient man, and when you have to go to the restroom, you're even more patient, right? So I go in, I flip the light on, and I take off. Guess what I found? The stand that used to be against the wall that's now in the... And I'm in, I went, oh! Tapes, what's the matter? I said, oh, somebody left a stand right in the middle of the bedroom floor. I should have moved it back. She said, oh, baby. I said, yeah. I said, anybody can make it. I said, let's just shove this thing on back a little bit. I thought I knew where everything was. In my house, I've lived there for years. We think we know where we need to step. We think we know how we're supposed to live. But I'm going to tell you something. Outside of a conversation with Jesus, outside of a relationship with Jesus, we can think we know, but we don't know until we ask Him. Just walk with Him. It is not complicated. Just walk with Him. Let Him lead. Allow Him to direct our life. Allow Him to convict you. Don't let people convict you. Let the Holy Spirit convict you. Seek first. Tell your neighbor, seek first. But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things, everything you need, will be added or will be given to you. If you seek the kingdom first, everything you need will fall in line. There's an alignment. Everything works better when it's in alignment. Are you with me? I've had two back surgeries over the year. My last back surgery, I think, was in the year... Tam doesn't remember. And if she doesn't remember, I don't remember. I think my last back surgery was in 2007. That sounds about right. That's what we'll call it. And the thing about it is my torso is crooked. It's kind of like this. And I have one leg now that's shorter than the other because my back likes to pull up on one side and so on and so forth. And everything works better when it's in alignment. And since I had the, my belly button's crooked. No, I'm not going to show you. No, not going to happen. And we'll be in the bathroom, and Tam will look in the mirror, and she said, "You're crooked." I'm like, "You're just now figuring that out." She said, "You're crooked." I said, "I know. I need to go see the chiropractor. Because if I go see the chiropractor, he can straighten me out. Sean can straighten me out if I just go see the chiropractor. But I haven't been there in a while, and I'm crooked. And the thing about it is, me knowing that I'm crooked won't straighten me out. Just because I know I'm crooked, it doesn't just poof, there it is, and I'm straight. In fact, making an appointment with the chiropractor will not straighten me out. Me going to the chiropractor and sitting inside of the waiting room won't straighten me out. It's only when I put myself before the chiropractor and I allow him to adjust me that I can walk right again. And sometimes I have to go back several times to get straightened out. Sometimes you're going to have to go back to Jesus several times. Sometimes it's a one and done. Praise God for you quick learners. But some of us were a little bit slower to learn. But if you want to walk right, you got to keep going back. Tell your neighbor, you got to keep going back. In 1 Thessalonians 5:23, it says, "But may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless at the coming of the Lord Jesus." This is how we get in alignment with God. Notice the order: spirit, soul, body. My body being crooked is not going to affect me getting into heaven. It's last on the list. It says spirit, soul, body. If there is a plan in getting in alignment with God, that means it's easy to get out of alignment of God with God very quickly. How many of you hit one of our West Virginia potholes? And when you get to 60, 70 mile an hour, you got a wobble there you never had before. I want to talk to you about seven ways that we get out of alignment with God. Seven signs that will help you determine if you're out of alignment with God. And I may only get to number one today. I don't know. We'll see. But the first one is this. You're out of alignment with God when you have no hunger for spiritual things. When you become satisfied, when we have become satisfied with where we are spiritually, we get out of alignment with God. When we adapt the attitude, good enough. We're out of alignment with God. Where's all the amens at? When we become content with the status quo, I'm just going to be real honest. I think church today, I'm not saying Maranatha, but I say church today has become content with our spiritual maturity, and we don't want to go any further. We don't want to ruffle any feathers. We say we want to see the dead raised, but do we? When was the last time you saw someone dead raised in a church? When was the last time you saw the dead raised on a football field? Well, he had medical assistance. I don't care. The man died 2 weeks ago tomorrow. Damar Hamlin had no physical issues going on in his body whatsoever. He died on a football field. He come up, he hit a man, he took a shot in the chest, and because of his heart rhythm, if your heart rhythm is just at the right place at the right time and you suffer a severe blow, your heart can't stop. That's what happened. He had just enough oxygen in his brain to stand back up, and as soon as he stood up, he just went limp and he fell out and he died. The first time ever they remember ever having to have CPR on the NFL football field. And he came back to life. I say that if God can't do it inside of his church, he'll take it to another arena where he'll get the glory. I say, let's not become the type of church. Let's keep a spiritual hunger going on between us, praise God. Let's hunger and thirst for righteousness so we can be filled. Let's have a desire to see blind eyes open and the deaf to hear and the lame to walk and the dead to rise and the cancer to be healed. And when your passion and emotions for spiritual hunger has diminished, we're out of alignment with God. It says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. This is the alignment of our priorities. In other words, you have to dethrone whatever stands between you and Jesus. I pulled this out this morning and people said, we're going to do some monkey trapping this morning. And I guess that this is so common that people in Maranatha, they know what it is now. And at first I got a little bit upset about it because I'm thinking, man, has it been that soon since I used this? How many of you have never seen this before? Raise your hand. Oh, well, praise the Lord. This is, in some countries, they trap monkeys. And sometimes they use a very simple piece of equipment to trap monkeys. They will use a jar or some type of a thing, what they call a monkey trap, and it has a hole in it. This has plexiglass so you can see what's going on, okay? This is for your viewing pleasure only. This is not a real monkey trap. I made it. George may be my first one. Somebody stole my first one, George. I went looking for it the other day, and you got it, Johnny? You have my monkey trap? Hey, George. Johnny borrowed my monkey trap. It's okay. He'll bring it back. I'm sorry, John. I never thought to call you to see if you happened to have the monkey trap. You probably just borrowed it from me. Yeah, and I take back what I said. Somebody stole it. Johnny borrowed my monkey trap. Brenda, do you really know what you're getting into? Huh. Yeah, write it down. It's okay. We're recording it. We'll give you a copy of it later. Just give us your email here. We'll just email it to you. But in some countries, they trap monkeys, and they use a thing called a monkey trap, and they will have something where the hole is just big enough for the hand to go in, but the fist cannot. And they will put a simple little bait in there for the monkey to. I use a banana because it's just a cliche that I don't really even know if monkeys like bananas, but that's the cliche. Oh, they do, Tanya? Oh, okay, Tanya knows. Do you have a pet monkey at the house? You want one? Hey, Jay. When I'm finished, I'll let you borrow. Somebody write this down. I'll let you borrow my monkey trap, and you can get her a monkey. But so anyway, I don't know, Pastor Terry. Holy Ghost help. So they will take a bait and they will put it inside of a monkey jar or a monkey trap, and the monkey comes along, and I'm talking about the alignment of priorities, about what we value. What stands between us and Jesus? What's between us and Jesus? And the monkey comes along and he finds the banana and he reaches in simple enough, but when he goes to pull it out, he can't pull it out because he has a hold of something that makes his hand larger than when it first went in. And he could go free if he would just let go, but because he won't let go of the bait, because he won't let go of that one thing that stands between him and freedom, he's caught. He's stuck. And when the captors come, he runs around as long as the rope or chain will allow him, but he's only in a certain circumference because he can't get away, because he will not let go of what's holding him in bondage. He could go free if he would just let go. What is between us and Jesus? I'm going to deviate from my message here this morning, and I'm just going to stay right here because I don't think I'm supposed to go any further. But anything that you would rather hold on to as opposed to seek after the kingdom, you're going to stay in bondage. And don't let the church put on you what it is. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Drugs killing people. So is food. People got to be living that alternative lifestyle. And what are you living that you nobody knows about? My point is, what are we putting between us and God? Yeah, it could be addictions. Yes, it can. It can be relationships. It can be tobacco products. It can be alcohol products. It could be pornography products. It could be prescription drugs. It could be illegal drugs. It could be sugar. It could be cheeseburgers. See, we don't like to talk about that. Because we just think that it only pertains to certain people. We can see people if they have certain sores on their body, and we know what type of drugs they're addicted to. And we look down our long nose at them and say, well, look at that. But what are you addicted? Sorry. What are we addicted to that no one else may know? And it says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these things will be added unto you. I don't know about you, but I like all the stuff that Jesus adds. But I only get it if I seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And you can come in here this morning and you can say, Pastor, but you don't understand. I don't have it on the inside of me to stop. And I say to you this morning in the name of Jesus Christ, yes, you do. Yes, you do. No, not you by yourself. But it tells me in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, it gives me the fruit of the Spirit. It's the fruit of the Spirit. And let me just read them to you, because this is where I'm going off script. This is how the Lord's directed me this morning. But the fruit of the Spirit. Now, I want you to understand, these are things that you cannot possess on your own and be in your greatest strength. You can have these qualities, but you can never be as strong in them as when the Holy Spirit empowers you to be strong in them. In other words, you can't possess these outside of the Holy Spirit. These are for the believer. That when you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, the Holy Spirit will empower you with these fruits of the Spirit that will make you strong so that you can say no, so that you can resist, and so that you can live a life pleasing to God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Well, Pastor, you don't know. I can't do it. No, you can't, but the Holy Spirit will give you the self-control to do it. Can I be real honest with you? You know, everybody knows I'm a pastor. But there are times that things tries to attach itself to me the same as it does you. And this is what I would say, that if you want to test to find out what may be standing between you and the kingdom of God or you and God, is abstain from something for a week. And see. And if you can't abstain from something for a week, I'd say there's a problem. Well, people's getting less and less amen, but I'm okay because I'm in the right place. I can feel the love coming in all over. Try it for a week. Try giving up coffee for a week and see how it goes. Try giving up sugar. Try giving up tobacco products. Try giving up alcohol. Try giving up porn. Try giving up sex for a week and see how it goes. Well, now, just calm down. I'm talking about self-control that the Holy Spirit rises up on the inside of you to overcome what's between you and the kingdom. It's how we live a holy life. It's how we live a life pleasing unto God. Listen, you can't do it on your own. I'm telling you, you can't. You can try it and you'll go so far, but you'll reach your limit to where you can't do it anymore. But that's when the Holy Spirit kicks in and takes you further than what you could go on your own. That's why when you see someone anointed, someone singing beyond themselves, it isn't them. It's the anointing kicked into that gift, taking them further, and they're looking real good, but it's really God that looks good. So what is it that's standing between you and Jesus this morning? Joey, I don't know how I want to do this morning. I don't know, because this isn't the way that I had it planned out. Yeah, okay. Joey, come on up. I want Jay, I'd like for you and Tanya to come up here if you would. Come up over here. Yeah. Yeah. Wayne and Shelby. It takes a while. Let's come up here and stand. Frank and Debbie, I want you to come up here. Huh. Yeah. Hey, Tom and Terry. Come up here. No offense, guys, we're going to have to start picking some younger ones. Well, okay, I'm going to be real honest with you. I'm going to be real honest with you, man. These are the people that 12 years ago when I got here, man, they helped me settle in. And I'm looking around and we're maturing. And some of y'all's faces is getting younger. And I'm realizing that, okay, we're going to make room for younger people because the ministry's got to go on. Yeah. Oh, it's going to mess somebody up bad. Manuel and Jenna, come on up here. Yeah, it's going to mess. Manny's saying, what? What? Manny here. What? Manny comes up. He'll come in to be doing any of your self-defense stuff on me. He'll come into self-defense class and he wears a small medium. He really needs an extra large, you know. His arms look all. Try to get out of here. Walks in like this. I say, hey, come up, pray. What? greater things on the inside of you. Just let it out. I need another young couple. This is going to do it too. Evan and Alyssa, come up here. Yeah. Oh, my God. Come over here. Somebody said, would you dress a little nicer if you didn't know? Hey, come over here. Somebody asked one day, said, hey, who's that one younger guy, got blonde hair? He walks around the church like he owns a place. And he said, oh, that's Evan Powell. That's Pastor Darren's boy. Oh, he didn't walk around a church like that. He walks around everywhere like that. You know why? Because nobody's ever told him any different. And I think there's some oil in the... Let's get some oil. I want all you get a little bit of oil in your hands so you can dip there. He's all mine. And I need a single woman, honey. Who is it? Oh, Christina. No, Christina and Jamie. Come on up here. We'll get the youngest of the young right here in the middle. Ooh. Yeah, everybody get some oil. This is what I want. I want everyone to stand, if you would. And I know this is different. But if you need help with an addiction, if you need help with something that is between you and the Lord, I want you to come and allow these people to pray over you. It doesn't matter who you come stand in front of. They'll just simply pray over you. But if you want that self-control that I spoke of in Galatians 5:22, the first thing you must do is ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart. You must ask Him to forgive you of all your sins and ask Him to come into your heart. And then you just ask. I started to tell you that there's times that things try to well up on the inside of me, Sam. There's things that try to attach itself to me. And I found myself lately praying, Holy Spirit, I'm asking for the fruit of the Spirit of self-control to rise up on the inside of me to where I can say no. Because the enemy doesn't fight fair. He'll wait till you get worn down, and then he'll hit you. That's when you're going to need the Holy Spirit's help to get you through. So right now, if you want to accept Christ as your Savior, you come, let someone pray for you. If you need help with an addiction, if you just need help with self-control, I want you to come. And don't be ashamed. Be honest, we all fight this battle. Don't worry about it. You just come and let him pray for you, as Joey sings. Go ahead, brother.
You are way make, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way make, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Never stop working, never stop, never stop working. Even when I don't see you working, even when I don't feel that you're working, never stop, you never stop working, never stop, never stop working.
Don't try to do it on your own.
Miracle work.
Come and ask for help this morning.
Light in the darkness.
You'll help.
My God.
Lord will help
you. They make miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we just come to you this morning. We ask of you to do what we can't do for ourselves, Father. We ask of you to help us to stand when we need to stand. And Father, I'm asking for everyone under the sound of my voice right now, that Holy Spirit, that you would come and that fruit of the Spirit of self-control would rise up on the inside of us, God. That our no would be no and our yes would be yes. Lord, that when temptation comes in, Lord, that we'd be able to say no and resist it. Many times it's just the fact that we don't want to say no. But Lord, help us to throw that crutch away. And help us to stand where you've called us to stand and fight for what you've called us to fight for. And Father, just deal with the hearts of your people, of whatever may be between us and you. And Lord, give us strength, give us wisdom. Lord, may there be a desire, a spiritual hunger inside of your people. May we have a desire to see signs, wonders, and miracles. May we have a desire to see souls saved. May we have a desire to see people delivered, set free, bondages broken, yokes destroyed, generational curses destroyed, and never to be seen or dealt with again. Father, I pray that you would just do unprecedented things in a very uncommon people. So, Father, we ask of you to do what only you can in a way that only you can do it. I thank you for who you are, and I thank you for your love toward us. And I ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Go ahead and just give God a great big hand clap of praise. And I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to go ahead and dismiss. But if you would like prayer, I'm going to ask all these couples to stay here after we dismiss. And if you want prayer, I just want you to come up and let them pray over you. It's real simple. I'll be honest with you. All you got to do to be set free, all you got to do is just let go. Just let go. Just let go and watch what God does. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for this opportunity to gather together in your house today. Lord, may we not take it for granted, but may we make the most of it. So, Father, I pray that you would move the way that only you can. I pray that you would just bless your people beyond measure. And, Lord, may you just give us strength to fight the good fight of faith. We thank you for it. We ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. May God bless you and keep you. His face shine upon you. And by God's grace, we'll see you Wednesday evening. Thank you for being here this morning.